Welcome to lunch, everybody. It's my great honor and privilege to introduce Dr. Annette Becker, Professor of Contemporary History at the Université de Paris-Nanterre, and an honorary senior member of the Institut Universitaire de France, as today's Edgar L. Neumann Memorial Plenary Speaker. Dr. Becker is recipient of some of France's highest honors, including Officier des Palmes Académiques, Officier de l'Ordre National de Mérite, and Chevalier de la Légion d'Honneur. She's been a visiting scholar in the United States on numerous occasions, including the Institute for Advanced Studies at Princeton, at Yale and Rutgers Universities, and the University of California at Berkeley, and a fellow at the Niles Lerman Center for the Study of Jewish Resistance at the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum. Most of us in this society probably know Dr. Becker for her scholarly work on war, memory, and trauma. Acclaimed scholar of the Great War and its aftermath, with over a dozen books, including the recent republication of La Guerre et le Froid, De la mort à la mémoire, and the recent Voir la Grande Guerre, Un autre récit, which received the Jean-Jacques Rousseau Prize in 2016. However, if you're like me, it's her co-authored France in the Great War, 1914-18, with Stéphane Audouin Rousseau and Leonard Smith, that is most often assigned to my undergraduates. Dr. Becker is also an acclaimed genocide scholar, having published on genocides and the abuses of internment camps, from the Armenian to the Rwandan genocides. Her recent publication, Les Cicatrices Rouges, France et Belgique Occupées during the First World War, concerns the traumatic practices of occupation during the Great War and their connection to the concentration camps and human suffering during World War II. Her forthcoming book, Messager du Désastre, Raphael Lemkin, Jan Karski, and Les Génocides, on the Nazi genocide of the European Jews, about the invention of the concept of genocide by Raphael Lemkin, and the reporting of the destruction by Polish patriot Jan Karski, will be released this January 2018. Dr. Becker has also written major works on the effects of memory and trauma of the war upon intellectuals and artists, including Maurice Halbwachs, an intellectual en guerre mondiale, Otto Dix, Der Krieg, La Guerre, War, Guerra, and Biographie de Guerre de Guillaume Apollinaire, which won the Grand Prix for Biography from the Académie Française and the Prix de la Légion d'Honneur. In short, Dr. Becker is a scholar who possesses the kind of depth and versatility to which we aspire, but few of us actually achieve. Please join me in welcoming Annette Becker to our society.
Thank you so much for your two kind words. And I feel a little strange to have to speak about presence and absence in front of a very present meal, but it is how it works, and I think it's the atmosphere you all put in this Western Association, and this conference in particular is so important, and we are speaking this morning about how to do great scholarship in a multi-minority societies, and I think to do great scholarship you have first to be friendly to each other and try to understand the other. And I think it is also what it is to do history. And that's why I choose this quotation to begin. All sorrows can be born if you put them into a story or tell a story about them. Isaac Dinesen, who is Karen Blixen, but this quotation has been used a lot by Hannah Arendt and also by Paul Ricoeur. So we are at the middle of the thing. And the cartoons I put to just in front to show presence and absence was in yesterday Le Monde. And it's about all the problem of the world we have now, but it works very well also for the end of the Great War. Litre de larmes et de sang, kilo de tristesse, heure de néant, kilomètre de chemin de deuil. So we'll try to get to that for 100 years. I begin by a quotation by the French philosopher Emmanuel Levinas, who was raised and living in Lithuania in 1914. He remembered in a very late interview, "A trouble began at the end of August 1914, a trouble which never ended, as if order had been disrupted forever." And then, "Very few memories, things come back to the mind in disorder. Pictures have been blurred in the changes, the moves, and memories run the risk of being learned more than remembered." The 1914 war never ended. Revolution, civil war, everything fuses with the war. End quote. It is this trouble, this disruption, that I would like to analyze, or more accurately, I would like to think about the Great War from its suppressed or distorted memory to its impossible recollection. Because Levinas tells us two very important things. First, that on what had been the Eastern Front, the war never ended. I agree with him, and would argue that it was not the only place where war and the trauma of war never ended after 1918. Second, he says that memories run the risk of being learned more than remembered. I think it's very important that we think about these reinventions and all kinds of memory gaps to conceptualize the impossible exit from violent and tragic confrontations. And it is true, we are still haunted by the long-term memory of the First World War. With its period of suppressions or oblivion, our thinking confused by the later horrors and large-scale massacres of the Second World War, followed by the wars of decolonization, not to mention the current warfare. So you have the war memorial of Arras from 1920, and then he had been a symbolic victim of the Second World War. But it goes on. Yesterday, Deir el-Zor was retaken by the Syrian army from the Islamic State. Deir el-Zor doesn't exist anymore. But Deir el-Zor, for me, was a site of the extermination camps during the Armenian genocides. So, again, it was in the actuality, 1915, 1916, 1 million people and half died, and suddenly yesterday, at a glimpse, Deir el-Zor taken back by the Syrian army. Since 1914, returned soldiers and their families had to cope with the reality of wound and death, while commemoration and compensation could only be symbolic or metaphorical at the national and global level. For 100 years, military fronts have played a dominant role in attempts to think the First World War, and justifiably so. But I believe that to understand the war memory at the wall, it is necessary to reflect not only on the soldier, on the soldier's war, but on everybody's war. Civilians were both what I would call collateral participants in combat, supplying the front with the fruit of their surplus labor, and collateral victims, suffering and grieving. But civilians were also at the very heart of the war, in particular territory invaded, occupied, raided, bombed, or genocided. So how is the specific violence inflicted by and upon military and civilian has been represented in its remembrance, forgetting, and deformation? I take another quotation from Arthur Koestler. He said in 1943, statistics don't bleed. It is the detail which counts. So I think we should quit statistics which neither bleed nor cry, and let's try to understand blood and cries with mourning and bereavement details. That's why I choose to finish this introduction, this very specific war memorial. It's huge. It's an arch of triumph. It's in a tiny, tiny little village, and there is only one dead. But who cares about the statistic? The same here at the other part of the world, in Ocean Spring, Mississippi, a war memorial for only one person. And the same in Auckland, New Zealand, a huge war memorial in the most beautiful setting for one dead. But this statistic don't count. What counts is what is behind all this. So I will present this culture of memories and the sacredness they involved through death, bereavement, hypermnesia, amnesia sometimes, and I organize my talk in 11 different short points and a lot of pictures. First, tragedy from industrial sound to silence. In 1917, after the American troops reached Saint-Nazaire, then the rest of Northern France, the poet Jean Cocteau heard jazz for the first time. It could have been James Reese Europe Orchestra of the 369 Harlem Hellfighter. Cocteau called it a domesticated catastrophe. I suggest that we extend it to the entire Great War, seen as an undomesticated catastrophe, except by the blood of the dead. I generally prefer the word tragedy because it encapsulates the world wars as I see it, a bloodbath where human beings sometimes could make admirable choices, either part of the myth or not, like the Debout les morts of Jacques Perricard, which is shown here in an incredible memorial in the Epage with a text of Genevois on it. I think the one who understood the best are the camouflage units. In this cartoon dialogue, you see a camoufleur saying, "You were a painter for theater set before the war. What are you doing now? Sets for a tragedy." Traces of life braided together with death, images of extreme violence present a double absence. That of the moment where the image was created, and that of the moment they are viewed, for instance, now, a century after the Great War. Going to the lines, the front of memory, we can explore the multiple fields of vision presented by civil societies in wartime and after, all filled with damaged men and women. Images and sounds enable us to descend into the visual abyss of war, of wounds, of death, and of memory. From industrial noise, you see here on this very short film segment, you have the end of the war. The sound suddenly stops. It goes to silence, the silence of cemeteries and war memorials, like the one in the first ossuary in Verdun. Two images of mourning infinite. As Freud said as early as 1915, modern warfare has produced extraordinarily traumatizing situations that nobody was prepared for. Mutilated bodies, deaths of so many young people, an entire generation lost, and the massive destructions of homes and of hope. You can see it very well in this incredible war memorial in Lodève, in the south of France, which shows so well the total obscenity of death. With this family looking at this soldier dead, but with his open legs, which is offering its body to the motherland perhaps, but mainly to worms which are devouring him now. This new world and its demographic revolution was, and Freud saw it very well, was supposed to make death disappear, but it's exactly the contrary which happened with the war. And for the first time of a generation, a young boy like this one could know his grandfather, but the father in the middle is now missing. Who could put this in literature? It's not a great poet who was also a veteran. Guillaume Apollinaire, in 1916, just after he had been wounded, published a book called Le Poète Assassiné. And he was wounded in the war, but this book has been written before the war, which is really interesting. And the Great War, in a way, coincided with Apollinaire's literary project dating from the turn of the century to write a novel on the end of the world. So this pogrom of poets was taking place during the war, and the war became the pogrom of everybody. And in the chapter 18, called Apotheosis, it describes the construction of the commemorative monument to the hero, which is Cronjamental, but could be also Apollinaire. And there is a dialogue between Tristouz and the bird of Benin. Picasso is the bird of Benin, and Tristouz could be all the women commissioning works. I must create a statue for him. What sort of statue? Marble? Bronze? No, that's too old fashioned. I must create a profound statue out of nothing, like poetry and like the war. Bravo, bravo, a statue made of nothing, a void. It's magnificent. And where are you going to sculpt this? Next day, the sculptor returned with workmen who clad the well with a wall, so effectively that the void took the form of the poet. The hall was full of his ghost. I think that from Apollinaire to the works of contemporary that were equally conceptual, everyone understood that the combatants of the First World War would be no more than phantoms. For a century now, artists have sought to master the war catastrophe which dislocated the world and its being between sufferings, cruelty, violence, and negligence. And the war memorials have been trying to say that, like in Villars, Those who fall for the fatherland live again in history. We have to think about it. The idea is the idea of the naming. They want to go on because they have names. And this guy inscribed his name at the bottom of a cave where he was doing the war. And the name after can be written on the war memorial, but is not there anymore. A woman or a symbolic woman is showing the name to the children. We are in Basque country here, so I choose some Basque monument to show that. I particularly love this one in Muguer. À ses enfants morts pour la grande patrie, la petite patrie reconnaissante. And this is very moving that it will be a Basque, and you have a Basque inscription on the one on Saint Esteban, and it shows again this tension between different sacred, the sacred for the fatherland and the sacred for the faith, and the two blend together, and you see it very well on the Saint Esteban. You have the Basque inscription, it's for Sandy, but in you, God of the army, give to the Basque soldier the eternal peace. You have the same here, this different sacred to represent grief on the left in the cathedral of Amiens, and the same on the Père Lachaise, where Marianne the Republic is comforting an Italian volunteer. It's also a world war. So, third, time and space, and it comes obviously from Maurice Alvax, when in the social frame of memory, he explained that individual memories always crystallize within a social framework, and that public events leave a deep imprint on those who live through them. He says also that individual recall in the literal biological sense, but actually it is the social group which is recalling. And it's very interesting for two reasons. The first reason is that he's perfectly right. The second is that when he wrote that in the 20s, there was an arsenal of memory around him, and he never wrote a single line on the First World War. His memory organization was done from kingdom which did not exist anymore, and that's really fascinating. The second thing in time and space is obviously the displaced trauma at the time of the war, and trauma which goes on. And I took this example at the Invalides in 2008. It was the burial of the last French veteran, and this woman had nothing to do with him, but she was burying her own grandfather, probably, or own something, somebody. And the same with this Australian who come to the north of France, and it looks that it is a real burial, but it is a burial, but of somebody who died in 1915, they have never seen in their entire life, they come dressed for a burial, and they are feeling the burial. And this is something in the presence of the war, which is so deep all over the world, that it is really amazing to think about. And it goes very far for French also, all the way to the Dardanelles, by example, where you have the cemetery and the monument of the time. And the French cemetery in the Dardanelles, in Gallipoli, as it is now, with this inscription from the poet Charles Péguy. So again, we are between two sacred, the sacred of the Republic and the sacred of the Catholic faith. Hein? Heureux ceux qui sont morts dans une juste guerre, heureux les épis mûrs, les épis moissonnés. It is a French official presence in Turkey now, with a poet, Peggy, who died in 1914, And it is still like that. And you have to carry on for 100 years to understand what really it means. The same with the American presence in France, I could not miss it, which is particularly huge, and it's huge because they came very late into the war and they wanted to show how important they were. And it's typically American, no? And it's really important to understand because it means that the war memory, it's all things personal and grief and mourning, but it's also politics. And in a way, it is politics through the graves, politics through the memorials. And this goes on for a long time. You have the same here with the Czech in the Père Lachaise. It is Marianne who is celebrating the Czech, but the Czech were not a nation in 1914, and they are in 1918, as was well said yesterday. And they were feeling that it was their political time, and the political time has to be rooted in the experience of the war. Fourth, gender from military front to domestic front and back. The American cartoonist Cesare did this cartoon, which I think is very good. This died, that this might live. Soldiers did not die for nothing on the battlefield. Their wives and children are still alive in their homes, but they are not living normally. They are now in mourning, and no doubt for evermore. In France, women and non-combatants in general, old or very young, are very often represented on memorials. Without domestic front, no war to go on, no weapons, no food, no love for the combatants. On certain monuments, this is obvious enough. So you have, I choose again two Basque monuments, which has very interesting and beautiful. The Bayonne Memorial is one of the biggest in France, and you can see this Basque guy going from his cow to the front, and it is a portrait of a real person. So you have again the community and the individual put together, and you have the different generation on the Biarritz one with the old parents, the widow, and the little child. But they never forget women, but they never forget also that men are much more important. This is the he called it the Ronde des Orateurs, the day of the opening of the memorial in Bayonne. You see, only male are speaking. There is no way women are doing it. Yet it will be too restrictive. Actually, some memorials show very well that you cannot do war if you're not all together. And this one is particularly beautiful because you have like the Dumézil tree functionality on top, the rooster, so it is France again. On the middle, and it is to believe, in the middle it is the combatant to fight, and down the woman who is working, plowing, and it is to work. And it means that the three together are to be there in order for France to function during the war and perhaps after the war. The women are mainly actually here to show the obscenity of death, the mourning in front of dead body, and so they cry most of the time. And this is my favorite one in the summer, when she's holding the coat, this empty coat. There is nobody there anymore, but she's clinging to it. That's why the contemporary artists are still going on with that. And I choose two, one of Mélie Kohanian, who is a French French artist who in 2004 did this work called The Girls of Chewell. And this woman working in the gas shell factories got totally yellow. And they were called the Canary Girls during the war. And so he's showing again and a totally other way of seeing the women at war. And this one I particularly like, the way feminist militants and artists have used the Arc of Triumphs or war memorials to show in the 70s up till now the specificity of women sacrifice in war. In 1970, you have it on the left, I took it from the film, there was a banner was held on top of the unknown soldier tombs in Paris, and it was saying, there is more unknown than the unknown soldier, his wife. And in 2010, the artist Valérie Bouillon, you have her here, set a real performance on the war memorial of this little city in Brittany. She had been hiding the names of the masculine heroes with pink material and adding to the everyday courage of women everywhere. So it's an interesting way to go on what was happening during the war, but take it to the new ways of militants. Five, resurrection. The women actually were seen before everything as weeping pietas, and as soldiers were seen as new Christ. That's why war memorials are very often something like new cavalries. We represent new modern ordeal in this war. And you can see it on normal war memorial. This is not a Catholic war memorial, it's a totally Republican war memorial. But the imagery comes from the Catholic sacred. You have it, obviously, Protestant and Catholic expression. So here in a temple, you have Lafayette coming and welcoming Protestant American to come to help. And the same on this very moving ex voto, because there is a big orthographic mistake in the middle. You moan and you hope, elle me l'a rendu. She gave me back my son. You can see again sacred and patriotism going very well together. In Doznak, by example, but there are a lot of examples like that. The war memorial on stained glass with a Christ is just in front of the church of the war memorial with the soldier. And it can be really the same. It doesn't matter. Some war memorials are only in churches, like this one, which is sort of very unique, where you have all the photos of the dead of the village put aside in front of Joan of Arc and very Christian parents. This sense of sacrifice for the motherland and for your faith obviously was shared very much by the Jews in France. But the Muslims were for a long time put aside. They were buried with Muslim rites, but they were not really visible unless the Jews. And they became very visible in the year 2000, so it's very short time, and it shows very well how the First World War is used nowadays by politicians and by groups without political agenda but with memory agenda to go on with acknowledgement of their sacrifice in the war. Artists obviously are doing the same with this idea of the infinite mourning of the time. A very I would say traditional artists like De Vambé and a very modern artist like Rouault, but you can see they show exactly the same idea of this sacrifice being impossible to totally recognize. And it's also true for the same kind of artists which were so important during and after the war, very modern artists, always this idea of the theater of war. One is Zinoviev. I really like this this art piece by him showing this the death in front of the curtain of the theater, and Dada example. Dada soulève tout, and Dada is obviously taking the entire world just out of the world war, and you don't know if Dada is going to keep it or if Dada is going to crush it, but it's another way to remember what was just going on. We don't know what was going on. It was unknown but to God, through the unknown soldiers. The conditions of fighting, the artillery mainly, have blown into pieces the soldiers. They became unknown. That's why there was universalization of the right of entombing unknown soldiers after the war, from Paris to London to every country except Soviet Union, impossible to speak about this war, except Germany, impossible to speak about this war. But the unknown soldiers were so important in Poland or in Czechoslovakia because they were new nations born out of this war, so they had to show this new way of being. So obviously we are here interested in the French case, and the French case has been huge in French literature, and I particularly love a novel where the detective Arsène Lupin is used for a time to make something very special. He has to convince a family that their son is the one under the Arch of Triumph. The mother says, "Not an hour, not a day, I never leave Paris." Why, madame? Because he's there in the tomb. Already in the 30s, artists and activists were mocking this triumph of the unknown as the champion of the sacrifice of the nation when everything left was so pathetic. So you have this poster, this anti-communist poster. What does a communist do? He spits on the unknown, soldier. The South African artist Paul Emmanuel has been reviving this tradition. He reflects on the bodies of the combatants, on the physical and mental fragility. So what he did a trail of banners with parts of his own body. And he wants to reflect on an age of the youth of the soldier, their masculinity, their virility, and on race. He's South African, he has a white body, but he also bears the name of dead soldiers who were black soldiers. And by analogy, the fact he put the name of the soldier on his own body recalls the branding of the slave. It's interesting also that his installation in 2014-16 had been in Thiepval. Thiepval is the biggest arch on the French territory, much bigger than the Arch of Triumph, which is there to speak about the French and British soldiers of the Battle of the Somme. So by putting his fragile work in front of the very heavy arch. He's also doing a statement. But Luitens, the architect, who is also the colonial architect of Delhi, by doing this arch, never closed it. It means that you can always put a new stone on top of it, which means that the infinity of the sacrifice will go for ever. In the same time, so this is the sum activities in 1916, and obviously François Hollande didn't want to come. But it was 2 days after the Brexit, so he decided he had to be there. So again, the First World War used for a different mean. I think I'm very late. I think we began late, or I'm late. I'm too much. I wanted to speak about denial of memory for occupied populations. So I go to that very quickly, where you don't see the sacrifice of the occupied population, or the fact we have no uniform than this one. Why? Because in Alsace they were in Germany at the time, then they have become France, so no uniform also for the prisoner of war. I stop on ethnicity because it seems to me a very important way to think about this memory, this invisibility which is here under Apollinaire, this Indian also have gas masks. So they are twice invisible in war, because they are Indians and because they have gas masks. But in commemoration in French colonies, you had a lot of war memorial, but always under the idea that paternalist officer will help these guys to begin to be French. And it took a lot of time for them to be recognized themselves, like in this statue, but 2007, where black soldiers are really recognized. And now, when you think about the war in reenactment, by example, every time, like in April 2017, a few months ago, you have all kind of color soldiers, which was not the case till 20 years ago. So it means also that the way memory is working has to be like a kind of a political correctness, as Kader Atia, a great artist, shows it very well, putting together the wound of the soldier and their ethnicity. He even did it through the movie J'accuse, putting together the accusation against the civil society, then the accusation against the war to finish off the accusation against racism. I finish perhaps by this hate and desecration, because it seems to me very important to understand what was going on at the time and is still going on now. You have here the monument to the Black Force in Reims and Bamako, which was put exactly the same in the metropolis, Reims, and in Bamako. But the one in Bamako was untouched, but the one in Reims was destroyed by the Germans in 1940, because they thought that to put black soldiers on a monument, is what I said yesterday at the lecture, was degenerate. And it showed the degeneration of France to have black soldiers on a memorial. And obviously they had the power to break this memorial. So it shows very well how you have been from, I would say, anti-German feeling, and you have it here on different memorials, which were also destroyed by the German, actually, when they came to France, to now feelings against the one who could be on the left front. And this very beautiful sculpture, which was put in 1998 to speak about the mourning of the entire soldiers, was destroyed. And it was destroyed because the extreme right, who did it probably, thought that it was degenerate art, and that the mutinies of 1970s were in the degeneration. And this is a text about this degenerate art. But the French state, it's pretty good, because they redid it. And it's a lot of money for a sculpture. So it means sometimes, I am not always a great defender of my country, but for this kind of thing, you can find people who are happy to pay a lot of money to put back a statue who was speaking about the mind of the people, and here François Hollande coming back to air. But in our new system of life, the monuments also are part of all kind of destruction, and it is a war memorial which has been destroyed by Daesh recently. To say what, I have no idea, but they thought it was important enough to do their statement on the war memorial. I go quickly with pacifism because obviously you know everything about it, and I will finish by this idea. Do we have now, in a way of seeing the Great War, a modern approach to the sacred? I could not resist this one in Washington last year. It's absolutely obscene again, but the obscenity, I think, it's interesting. And the camouflage has begun very early on. It began with Vaché here speaking about life being now a cinema. And it goes on with Cubism and Charlie Chaplin in Cubism doing exactly the same thing. And so we have all kind of camouflage. This is a camouflage of the Douaumont Germans. There were no German there. Douaumont was all French. You wonder why there were so many dead bodies of French, because there was not a single German. But it took 70 years to have a German there, just hand by hand, and last year was a great reconciliation from French heroes to others, which Charlie Hebdo thought very, very funny. And I finish with them. I think we owe them that. At the time, it was better. It's just 1 month before the attack on Charlie Hebdo in 11th, 2015. Before, it was better. We knew how to have fun. But Charlie Hebdo is going on now. And in 2017, they did a number of interesting drawing. One on environment. The ocean now is an aeolian. And so they did not die for nothing, because they died for climate change, against climate change. And it just to finish, it is just since I was using Charlie Hebdo, I was putting together this war memorial of the very Republican stained glass window in Le Kremlin Bicêtre, where you have Marianne as the goddess of the First World War. And during the huge demonstration after January 2015, some theater group had put a huge Marianne, and it was obviously the way the war memorial are done now to go on with anything which is a great trauma and a great way to give back names, to give back feelings, and this comes from the First World War. So we are between presence and absence. The same with this suicide of Breton peasants. So we are on the other side now. They are demonstrating about the fact that the farms, they cannot live on the farms anymore, and a lot commit suicide, and they decided to do a huge graveyard in front of the biggest war memorial and very Catholic war memorial in Brittany. So the war is still among us. Thank you.